Now, you haven't seen that club for nearly 20 years, but you're going to meet those friends sitting at the top because they're here now. Come in. Dorothy Bennett, Terry Edwards, George and Nancy Llewellyn, and Josie Downey. Now, Mrs. Bennett, I believe she used to give you a bit of trouble with her songs, right?
She certainly did. She used to say to me, "Don't play, Mrs. Bennett, because I'll sing out a tune." I said, "Never mind, Shirley, have a bash. I'll follow you, even if it means playing on all the black notes."
Well, while still packing pots by day, you began singing at night at the Cardiff clubs. Then in 1954, you're noticed by a local agent who gives you your first job in a touring review called Memories of Al Jolson. You leave the security of your home, and for the next 6 months, you tour with this review. In that show, you sang a duet with a man you called Uncle Ed. And Uncle Ed is here tonight, comedian Eddie Reindeer. Called you Uncle Ed, but you had a pet name for her too, hadn't you?
Yeah, well, we used to have a little game switching names, and one day she called me Reddy Reindeer, and I called her Burly Chassis.
That's how it got
Yeah,
Burly Chassis.
It also helped you, didn't you, Eddie, with her very first record.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Well, you see, the show was coming off at Wood Green, and I thought, now, if I make a test record with her, I might get her on the discs, you see. So we went up to a little place just off Shaftesbury Avenue, didn't we?
Yes.
And we made this little record. As a matter of fact, we made two. One for Shirley to take home to her dear mum, and one for me to take round the record companies. Well, I didn't have any luck with mine. I couldn't whip up any interest at that particular moment. But that is show business. Yeah. But Mum had a lot of luck with hers, didn't you, Mum? As a matter of fact, it was worn out in about 6 weeks. But I've got mine here now.
No.
Would you like to hear it?
Never been broadcast before, but we have, as Ed says, that one copy. And Shirley, this is what you and Eddie sounded like 18 years ago.
By the light of the silvery moon,
on the silvery moon,
I love to spoon,
I love to spoon,
with my honey and the croon,
just you,
honeymoon,
honeymoon,
we'll be shining in you,
we'll be shining in you.
Eddie ends, you're out of work. It's a single ticket back home to your mum and to Cardiff, and there you take a job as a waitress. It looks as if your career is over before it really begins. Then one day, a telegram arrives inviting you to London for an audition at 5 o'clock in the afternoon of February the 14th, 1955. The audition was successful, and soon you're singing at a Mayfair night spot, the Astor Club. Now, one man who knows about that, who is at this moment in Spain, but just before he left, he told us about the call that he made to you, and here he is, Michael Sullivan.
Hello, Eamonn. Hello, Shirley. I want to recall the night at the Astor Club that Jack Hilton was there by accident. And as usual, you finished your cabaret act on stormy weather, and as usual, I got the shiver down my spine. But fortunately, he did that night, too. As he turned to me and he said, "My leading lady at the Adelphi has fallen sick, Mike, and could your girl open tomorrow night?" I looked a little bewildered and said, "Well, sure." But I wasn't too sure whether he was serious. So I didn't tell you until the following morning. I then called at your hotel, and you were staggered like I was. We ran to the Adelphi. We went through all the rehearsals, which were long and strenuous. And if you remember, we were still rehearsing when the people were actually walking in the theater. The critics were there, and that night they claimed you as the great new find. And that's what you were. Marshall, God bless you.
Thank you, Michael Sullivan. Well, it was was a fantastic moment, and as Michael said, next morning the papers were hailing the birth of a new star. And you, Mrs. Bassey, received a very special telegram at home that day.
Yes. She said, I want you all to come to London. She said, if you haven't got the money, she said, borrow it. She said, and I'll pay you when you come to London.
Well, that was the result of the call you made following the telegram, and you all did go, and you were there at the Adelphi, and a few weeks later, at Shirley's first night, when she starred at the Café de Paris. Now, that night, everyone wanted to come back to your small dressing room there, but you only allowed two, there was only room anyway, to have this picture taken here. You see it over there, a picture of your mother and the man you dedicated one of your songs to. A keen fan has been at many of your opening nights since, one of the stars of this year's Royal Variety Performance, top international entertainer, and he's here, Liberace.
Yes.
I believe, Lee, that your admiration for Shirley's singing caused you a little trouble in traffic recently, right?
Well, that's true. I don't think Shirley knows this, but I have all of your records, and I stopped to pick up your latest one at the time, which was a car tape of something else.
Yeah.
And I put it in my car, and I got on the Los Angeles freeway, and I'm driving along, and all of a sudden, you came to this fabulous song called Excuse Me.
Yeah.
And I couldn't drive and listen at the same time, so I pulled into an illegal zone so I could listen to your record, and I almost got arrested. and a cop pulled by, you know, and he said, what are you doing here? And I said, I'm listening to Shirley Bassey. And he looked at me as though I was, you know, gone potty. And but I love you so much, and I have all your records.
What makes you admire her so much as an artist, Lee?
Well, Shirley is the stuff that superstars are truly made of. Everything she sings is from within. She is an intense singer, an exciting singer, an electric performer, and I've seen her take an audience and put it right in that magic hand of hers. And only a great, great artist with great talent can do that. And she is that.
It's impossible to stop you singing on stage or off. And one Christmas, when you decide to liven the party up with a song, you even bring your hostess in on the act. That hostess retired from stage nearly 20 years ago, but she's making a comeback for you tonight, a great variety star once billed as the voice of the stars, your good friend, comedian, and impressionist, Florence Desmond. Yes. Tell me, how did Shirley begin her impromptu cabaret?
Well, I could tell you many stories about Shirley, but this Christmas party was really one of the funniest, because you don't have to ask Shirley to sing. She just does it at the drop of a hat. But it so happened that we did have a wonderful pianist there, and she sang and she sang and she sang, and then we arranged a little joke. I got dressed up in the most awful tatty drag, and my husband, at a given cue, turned on the radiogram, and I came on in this awful tatty drag, and I did Big Spender to Shirley's playback. Well, then later on in the evening, about 2 o'clock in the morning, Shirley fortunately took off her stiletto heels and got on the billiard table and did Big Spender to her own record. Then she asked me to join her, which I must say was an awful lot of fun, really doing that.
The two of you together?
Yes, we did kind of a funny double act.
It was very funny double act.
Yeah, it was a funny double act.
Yes.
On the billiard table.
On the billiard. You would like to repeat it, Michelle?
We haven't got a billiard table.
I would like to
repeat it. Well, do the billiard table. Yes, we are.
You're kidding.
Piano. You started off something.
Oh,
right.
The minute you are in the joint.
a man of distinction, a real big spender. Good looking, so refined. So wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my mind? So let me get right to the point. Man, I see. Hey, big spender. Hey, big spender. Hey, big spender. Spend a little time with me.
Hey, big spenders. Thank you.